आप सबका स्वागत है आज के इस कार्यक्रम में. सो फर्स्ट आई विल इंट्रोड्यूस प्रोफेसर वैद्यनाथन. ही हैज वर्कड इमेंसली ऑन इकोनॉमिक एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ कास्ट सिस्टम एंड द कास्ट स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ इंडियन सोसाइटी. कास्ट एज सोशल कैपिटल, दिस प्रोग्राम इज बीइंग होस्टेड बाय इंडिक अकेडमी. And we all know that Professor Vaidyanathan, R. Vaidyanathan ji, is a highly experienced teacher who recently retired after being part of faculty of IIM Bangalore. He was there for almost 30 years. He was immensely popular amongst the students and faculty both, and is currently committee member of many regulatory bodies of Government of India as well as other agencies such as RBI, SEB, SEBI, IRDA, etc. He is also associated with many corporates as member of their boards. He comments regularly on matters of importance such as nation's economy and writes for a number of newspapers. Professor R. Vaidyanathan is now Cho S. Ramaswamy Visiting Professor of Public Policy at Shastra University, Tanjavur, that's in Tamil Nadu. So, a quick background about the current talk. Now, we all know that caste has been despised by nearly 150 to 200 years of continuous narration against it, looking through a prism of religious, socio, and economic aspects of the Protestant Padrism, which we call it. But it still thrives in post-liberalization India, post-liberal India, and it still thrives in all the communities irrespective of religious affiliations, whether they are Muslims, whether they are Christians, whether they are neo-Buddhists, or whether they are other communities. The establishment and running of businesses tap into these caste networks, both in terms of arranging finance and providing access to a ready workforce. By and large, caste has only been studied from a religious, socio, and political angle. Though it is widely accepted that caste has economic ramifications, any study of this aspect has been limited to looking at caste groups in terms of their per capita income, their representation in various professions, and other statistical details. Caste as social capital examines the workings of caste through the lens of business, economics, and entrepreneurship. It interrogates the role caste plays in the economic sphere in terms of facilitating the nuts and bolts of business and entrepreneurship, finance, markets, and workforce. Through this qualitative view of caste, an entirely new picture emerges, which of course Professor G will highlight upon, which forces one to view this age-old institution in a new perspective. We all know that caste is also a great social matrix. It solidifies and gives strength, inner strength to our society and our nation. Whenever, if you want to attack a nation or a society, if you want to destroy it, you have to destroy its all matrix structure, how various groups and peoples and individuals are linked to each other. Now, there is no caste in so-called caste as we call in India, in maybe Korea or Taiwan or China, Japan, or in the tribal communities of Africa. Tribal communities of Africa are great liberal in every view, where maybe there is no discrimination based on gender, caste, hierarchy, whatever. But still, they have been completely bulldozed by the Western Abrahamic, whether they are Christian or Muslim groups. Now, I'll tell you something about Indic Academy, which has organized this event. The organization, the organizer of this launch is Indic Academy. It's a non-profit seeking group to bring an intellectual, cultural, and spiritual renaissance based upon Indic civilizational thought. The organization enables public intellectuals to discover their potential, transform them as thought leaders, and nurture them to become social entrepreneurs. Indic Academy also incubates, invests, and assists social enterprises, delivering a product, service, or an experience that is based on Indic thought. These aims are achieved through scholarships and grants, courses and programs, networks and platforms and affiliates. Indic Academy provides scholarships to students and seeks to establish relationship with existing universities and institutions. Currently, we have an MOU with Kanchi Math, Sanchi University, and Chinmay Vishwavidyapeeth. The organization provides fellowship, research, and travel grants to scholars and public intellectuals, publishing grants to digital platforms and first-time authors, grants for various events and projects, and entrepreneurial grants for nurturing entrepreneurship such as Pondi Lit Fest, Bharat Shakti, and the recently organized Indic Teen Fest. So without much ado now, I would like to welcome Professor Vaidyanathan to please come and deliver his talk. Thank you all.
Good morning to all of you, and thank you for that introduction. And at the outset, I would like to thank Indic Academy as well as Karan here, who has put in a lot of effort in organizing this meet. And we have not, of course, there are other people at Hyderabad and Bangalore and other things who have been also put in a lot of work in this. And some of my book, including Caste, Social Capital, is kept outside. I would strongly recommend that you buy them. I'm not telling you read them. I'm only telling you buy them. That is adequate for me, because asking people to read is nowadays considered as a not a good thing. Because if I tell my students in my institute, you read something, they say we may take you to Human Rights Commission and other thing. That professor is harassing us, and you know, he is asking us to. So reading habit is gone. Writing habit is long time before gone. They, none of them can write one page, I can assure you on that. And they all want, what is this called, multiple choice. So they can tick any one of them. And anyhow, so this book idea, when I was discussing, many of my colleagues were telling, you are entering into a very dangerous zone. What has happened, unfortunately, in India is the word caste has become a four-letter word. You know, if you say caste, finished you are. Oh, immediately you are casteist, you are hierarchical, you are feudal, you are, you know, everything under the sun you are, other than being a progressive. And so that is the thing. What motivated, or what you may loosely call instigated me, is there are something like 850 clusters in India according to United Nations, what you call the survey, their UNIDO survey. And much later I will tell you, almost all clusters are caste clusters. They are all having very good economic activity. So I had occasion to travel to a place called Tirupur, very near to Chennai, near to Coimbatore actually. And it's one of the major, you know, export center for osiary, bunions, undergarments and other thing. Now, of course, it's something like $10 billion or something plus. I am talking about late 90s. So that time it was not so big, but it was coming up. There are individual entrepreneurs having 600, 700 crore of turnover that time. Now there are entrepreneurs having some 1400, 1500 crore. Or even one of them is 1800 crore, if I remember, turnover. So 18,000 crore, sorry. So huge industry. Now, so that time when I was very fascinated, because it's one of the, you know, what one can call, you may loosely call that godforsaken towns type of thing, you know, backwaters of. And how come so much activity has started here? Then I probe, and it's a agriculture, originally an agriculturist place, and they were facing periodic drought and no rains and other thing. So couple of them, got access to some machines in order to make some of these garments. So there was a small amount of cotton being grown nearby. So they used that, and there was a local market here and there, and what we call the Sunday markets. In many towns in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, on specific days there are markets which are, on the road actually. All type of things are sold there. So they began to go there and sell this, and it had some good demand. So, and slowly they expanded, and then somebody suggested to them who came from Europe. So these type of products are very much appreciated there. Why don't you? So one of them went there, and then it's a big industry. So when I was looking at it, I found out that almost all of them originally who were pioneers in this are all what are called gounders. Gounders have got some 35 to 40 subsects, but broadly they are all called. And they are called Kongu Nadu is the western Coimbatore area, and they have all sort of pooled resources, and some of them succeeded, some of them didn't succeed, but others helped them, those who did not succeed. And then they had the market information of Europe, they shared with each other. So this is how the whole thing. Then 2002 World Development Report of World Bank devoted two full pages on this group. They explained about Tirupur and other thing, and they also told that the Gounder community's network has phenomenally helped in terms of building up this place and other. So that gave me some amount of, because most important it is, who cares about what Professor Vaidyanathan says. World Bank report itself has told two pages. This is very, very important. Our umbilical cords are tied to white people. So unless they, certificates, give a chapa, nobody is going to bother about it or anything. So after that, I went to another place called Sivakasi, which is nearby place again. That's one of the vibrant center for crackers, matches, and now printing technology. Originally, it was for matches actually. Somewhere in the 30s, it's also a drought-prone area actually. So two of the Nadar community people, again, there are so many subsects of Nadars, but they are all called Nadars now. So they were encouraged by somebody in Chennai, you are suffering so much, you are not having any job. That time he got one information that there is a job at Wimco in Calcutta. Wimco used to be the major matchbox manufacturing firm. So they are wanting people. So we put them into a train and they went there. They worked in Wimco, these two people. They picked up some idea about how to make these matches in terms of sulfur and mixing and other thing. So after a couple of years, I do not know, some of you may be knowing that in the olden days, even today of course, where the manual matches making is taking place, the number of years you work is much lesser, including women, because you get into diseases and problems and other things. So they came back. Then they thought they brought along with them some machine and set up the facility here, and then they started manufacturing matches. And post-independence, that industry got some amount of reservation and small scale and other thing. So they did, 80% of the matches today comes from that part of the country only. And they also, as a corollary or as a forward linkage, they went into cracker making, because they know it's a very flourishing industry, but for this recent Supreme Court, all these issues otherwise. Cracker, they were using wrapping papers. So somebody suggested, why do you want to buy all this wrapping paper? Why don't you print here itself instead of buying all these old newspapers and other things? So they started printing. And they are really a very good, in India actually, that's a major printing center today is at Sivakasi. Very colorful, very artistic, and they are very expert in printing papers, to the extent I was told Obama ordered 500 diaries exclusively to be given to other prime ministers and whatever that group. And all the 500 went from Sivakasi. He picked it up and at a huge price, obviously. It's a very, precious type of thing. I want to, but many of these things are not even known to us in India itself, first of all. Anyhow, so these two made me think something is happening in our, it's not just that is these economic clusters are not swayambhus in the sense they didn't just like that sprout from somewhere. And the post 50s, Planning Commission has prepared a lot of documents on these economic clusters, but none of them ever mentioned about caste or community or anything. It all was made to appear that, you know, some of them got started and the government finance was there, they were. Late 80s, one report on leather industry talked about Muslims being dominant in the leather industry as owners and scheduled caste being in the working side. And that report was very interesting. That's the first time a mention of a community or caste was made by the one of the government organization in India. Because I think most of you will know, we will come to that. We abolished caste in 1950s. So after that, there is not supposed to be any caste at all. At least we abolished things on paper. Like this, we also abolished caste. So this report came. And that's the first time they mentioned about why Muslims are more into Hindu. Caste Hindus are not so active in, because the usage of cow in the leather industry. And then I had occasion to, of course, I decided and I visit as many clusters as possible. I went to Surat, I went to Rajkot, I went to Jamnagar, I went to Punjab, Ludhiana, various UP and Northeast, all the places I began to, much of it I spent from my pocket, some of it I got some research funding and other thing. Then I was abroad. Very interestingly, the west coast of US, huge number of hotels are run by Patels, a small group again from India, most of you might be knowing about it, in Gujarat, Lehua Patel and Kadua Patel. Lehua is the more popular Patel. There, the motels are called actually Patels now. They are no more called as motels because these people are so dominant in the picture. I was told by one of the leading lights in that there are in all 76,000 hotel units in US. 4-star, 5-star, 3-star, 2-star, including this 0-star, you may call it, motels. All this, 76,000. He says out of 34,000 are by Indians, owned or and run by Indian. And more importantly, 26,000 are by people 40 kilometer around, in and around Surat. They call themselves Surtis. So I was amazed actually. It's not a small number. 26,000 out of 76,000 is a, and all are by the Surtis. They have a huge network. And they also entered into petrol pumps and then through that to retail shop, pharmaceutical and other thing. And now they were telling me in US that in another 5 to 10 years, we should have 80% of the trucking industry in US. The trucks which carry goods from one place to another, that they are planning to slowly acquire. So this is something which, then I was in Antwerp, which is in Belgium. One of the diamond centers. For some other conference I went there, I was staying in a small, 4-star or 3-star. I saw in the buffet table, Jain meals on board was there. I was puzzled actually, of all the places in Antwerp, I can imagine some vegetarian or some board like that, but Jain meal is something highly, specialized. In India itself, you don't see in many places boards. So I asked the manager, he told they are one of our major customers. Then I realized in Antwerp, diamond industry, world diamond center, 75% of the diamond industry is controlled by two groups. One small group called Palanpur Jains. This will be 0.00001% of our population. Other is Patels. These two are the major people who own so much, they take the raw diamond from African countries and other thing. In Surat, it is all polished and then sent back to Antwerp. If I remember, it is Wall Street Journal, I think, wrote long time before an interesting article. The Jews were controlling something like 70% of the diamond trade in the world in the 70s, 80s and now it is 70% the other way by the Jains and Patel. So the report suggests that this is the first time in the history of the world Jews were defeated in business without violence. That's something very, because they have been defeated several times. They were beaten up or they will be, you know, shops will be burnt or something. But this is the time in which they were. So that is a small group actually. Again, they come from this Saurashtra area, which is a drought prone area. So something very interesting, drought prone area farmers slowly getting into business activity is becoming. This is one of the ways in which they could diversify or they could get into this activity. Then of course there are so many other clusters I have covered in the book. One in a famous, interesting one is in Ahmedabad, which is the kite flying group, which is mostly by Bora Muslims actually. It used to be some 70 crore industry. Today it is 1100 crore industry. Because the local, that time chief minister who is currently prime minister and various others later also, they made kite flying into a huge, you know, international festival. So the large number of foreigners come now, they, you know. So this is a very major, and it's all significant portion is by Muslim, and it is distributed among Muslim women in, who don't even come out or something, but who are in their respective location, and they make the kites and all, you know, what one can call, you may call modern type of kites, and you know, color kites and kites with this and kites with, you know, it become a very huge industry and massive amount of what you call entrepreneurs as well as investment. And so this is the sort of a thing which made me, I would not say I have covered all the clusters, but I would have covered some 80-90 clusters at least, out of that, major clusters and other. Anyhow, that made me the motivation behind doing this work. Now, couple of things. The hierarchy in caste, in terms of 1, 2, 3, 4, was created in 1881 by the British census. Let's be very clear about it. Prior to that, did caste exist? Yes. Did hierarchy exist? No. You cannot produce any evidence prior to 1881 that this sort of a fourfold classification is there. One which often my Marxist friends quote, and nowadays everybody quotes this, one Purusha Sukta slogan, which says that, you know, the Brahmins are supposed to come from face and, you know, the others from the chest and the leg. And the point they miss out is, though feet is not considered as impure or anything, this is only considered as impure by the communist and EVR children. In our tradition actually, if you go back, feet is worshipped actually. There are many temples in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, I can show you, where the feet of the god is the one which is actually worshipped. And all the Kalidas and other, you know, the Varnana, we call it in terms of exposition of goddess and gods, is Padadi Kesanta Varnani. It's starting from the feet, it goes up to the head. That's how the beauty of the god is explored. It's not head to feet. It's a feet to head. Anyhow, that one sloka could not, you know, be, you know, again and again, 150 times quoted, and, you know, it's not something which is. There is second point, most important is, of course, the word caste itself, many of you may be aware, is not of English origin. It's a Portuguese origin. They went and did conquista. They conquered all the earlier places and Indic population in Latin America and other thing. And so they created the word conquista, which is the, and these were treated as castas, in the sense those which are not worthy of even being considered or something. That's how the word came. And now, couple of two, three quick points. Sardar Patel merged something like 561 kingdoms in India. If you look at that, all 561 were ruled by either OBCs or SCSTs. no other. India is the only very interesting country where the erstwhile rulers get reservation benefit in the, in no other country rulers will, it's a very, it's always, we are more interesting, right? The second point is, if there was so much oppression, depression and all the words used about caste for 1500 years, there should have been caste wars in India. Between Kurmis and Yadavs, between Kioris and Yadavs, and between Tevars and Vanyars, Linkayat, and so many. So I asked actually my historian friends, some of them are renowned historian, where are the caste wars? There should have been plenty of caste. You look at the Europe, even though there was strictly they are not called caste, but there were many clans, many, so many wars were there in the Europe in 1,000 years of its history. Actually, it's full of wars only. European 100-year war, crusade, jihadi, so many wars. In India, there were no caste wars. So, if it's very fascinating civilization, that means it was oppressed and depressed for 1,000 years, but nobody revolted and had wars against other caste. It's not easy to imagine such a group of people who will just sit in a corner and until this Ambedkar and EVR came. No, that that logic is not there. Should have been, right? My Marxist historian told they will come back to me about caste wars. Last 10-15 years they have not they say some caste conflict, but that is in the post-independence. There are many caste conflict, but that's more in terms of political parties. We will come to that. Okay, the first census created a hierarchy. The explanation is given in 1891 census by the census commissioner. Why did we create hierarchy? Because we wanted to arrange Indians in a mirror image of what we have in Britain. The civil servants are considered as A class. Then there are middle groups, which are officers and other things. Then there are clerks, then there are peons. So we have four categories. So we thought we will create also four categories here. This is what the explanation given. The first census was not very great success. 1881 census, they could identify 1930 caste only, the whole country. And very interesting, 300 of them less than 10 members. That caste considered only 7 or 8 members. But more important is, roughly 160 or so, one member caste. Only one fellow, mathematically speaking, it is called single element set. So that fellow told, I belong to this caste. Who else? There were none. So the British were not happy. Because they wanted to classify the whole thing. So what they did was, in 1891 census, they told the enumerator, you must fix the caste of everybody. So pakdo this fellow, look at him, and then you say you are Vaishya. Look at another fellow, so you are Rajput. Like that, you must, this is the first time in the census situation where the enumerator were given the freedom. Normally, enumerator may look at the refrigerator or television in your home and other thing and put you into one economic group. Sometime it happened because the fellow may not be wanting to tell how much is his income or expenditure. So, just. But the caste as an identity, enumerators were given the preference. That is something. And even then, there were a large number of problems associated with enumerating this. Because we didn't have this hierarchy issue. There were 2-3 issues. One, of course, our sociologist Dipankar Gupta says, who is from Delhi University, he says, you may classify somebody as backward, but he never accepts his backward caste. You go and ask him, are you backward caste, he will slap you. He says, I am forward, I come from Surya Vamsh, I am Indra. All the caste, very interesting thing. They say their forefathers are Indras and Varuna or Yama or Yama is not so popular, Agni or something like that. This is one thing very, very interesting. They all say that they are actually descendants of some god. So there is no question of, for reservation I may claim I am a backward caste, get government job, but don't call me as And many of them also argue that they are actually kings. They were kings. They were cheated in between, and now they are in this position. This is the one particular thing. No caste want to accept that they are so-called backwarders. And over a long period of time, I'm not going to enumerate it, so many number of caste actually vanished. In the sense, they have got into other surname and other thing. And so many number of caste are also got social mobility and other thing. They have moved from one location to another location. So the original core is gone. And post-independent phenomena is aggregation of caste is taking place. For instance, there are, believe me sir, 415 Jats. 415. I was very fascinated actually. I went through the list. Many of them I can't pronounce even properly. But now all of them call themselves as Jats. Some 50 years before they were not known as Jats. They were known as subsect only. There were three major caste of Tevars and 70 subcaste of one group called Tevars in Tamil Nadu. Now all of them call themselves as Tevars. So what is happening in post-independence India, because of electoral politics, aggregation is taking place. People want to, you know, group themselves as a bigger, so that you can get votes. And for instance, there was no caste like Marathas. If you go back in history 40, 50 years before, but today everybody is, you know, oh, he is a Maratha. That's all. He is some sort of a. So this is happening all over the place. One is for vote. Other is obviously for the government, you know, chakri, government job and other thing. This is what is the. So the aggregation is taking place today. Everybody wants to be identified with a larger grouping. While as it was more disaggregation in the earlier, there everybody wanted to have a special identity under a subsect thing. We are different than others. Okay. So last caste census was in 1931 during the British regime. They did 1941, because of the Second World War, not much was done. The census was not very, because the British government felt that no point in focusing our so much resources into this census itself, you know, because of the war and other things. Then 1951, the government of India decided we will not have that caste column in the census, because Nehru declared that we don't have any more caste. So that's all. So, and most of our in India situation is by declaration. For instance, we have declared by an act of parliament that dowry is abolished. All people are happy. So whenever some discussion takes, dowry is abolished. Finished. So we are a nation of, I call it as declarations. Similarly, caste discrimination is abolished. All are nodding their head. Because there is an act actually for that also. Right? Then similarly, caste itself was abolished by Nehru. He said no need. So there is no census information on caste. 51, 61, 71. Then all this late 70s, all these small bushfires were there everywhere about extra reservation. Why SCST only should have a reservation? Why not other groups? So this was very, so it was felt they constituted on Mondal Commission. He declared this. He used 1931 census, which is the only base available actually. And, prorata, you know, simple. 1931, so much. So, 1981, somebody explained to him what is meant by linearity and prorata. If there were 100 people in 31, out of that 40 people were OBC, then in 81, so many people, so many are, so he declined. So, that's the basis on which VP Singh government announced actually the most unscientific way. But anyhow, one cannot. Because if somebody says unscientific about government, people get upset. Because government is supposed to be full of science, right? So, we will not argue on that. Now, very recently, there were huge amount of debate and other thing. 2011 census, they wanted to have caste. A lot of parties, you know, Bahujan Samaj Party, DMK, all parties were demanding. We must count caste. That time the census commissioner told, don't do that. Not because he was against it. He told it's a very, very cumbersome process. Identifying a caste itself is not going to be easy. You know, you ask a fellow what caste you are, he will say something which is not in your list. You can't even tick. So this is what is the problem. But anyhow, finally it was argued and decided they will conduct a caste census, not as part of the regular census, but as part of a additional information purpose. Some of you in your household, some people might have come and asked you about this. Anyhow, this was 2011-12, right? And now that report is not released. That's kept in cold storage. The reason is too many complications. 33 crore households were visited by the enumerators. Roughly 33 crore households are there in India that time. And 4.6 million entries were added about caste. 4.6 million caste were noted, which means every caste on an average 72 households only in India as per this census. Only 72, not more or so. It's created a huge problem. Then 65,000 caste are not there in the traditional anthropological caste list at all. Maybe enumerator problem, or maybe the fellow says something, the fellow writes something, you know, all these are. For instance, in Karnataka, NAIK, NAOAK can create such a big difference. Difference between getting two promotions in government service and not getting any promotion at all. So this lot of cases are there. People will claim I am NAIK, other fellow will say, no, he is NAOAK, and from Tulu or Kannada, it has to be rewritten in English and all. Anyhow, so this whole thing is such a messy thing that was handed over to Niti Aayog to sort it out. Niti Aayog thought, what is this? Already we have got enough in our hands. And plus this sorting it out is not a easy thing. So anyhow, out of these 330 million, 67 million cases were sent back to states. Respective, because they may know much better. Jharkhandi, state may know about, and they were supposed to solve all this problem. 14 million of them are still pending. I'm giving you all inside info or whatever it is. And the government says that we are closely monitoring the issue. Closely monitoring means we are not doing anything. Let us be very frank about it. That is the word governments normally use. Sir, huge floods, Bangalore is sinking. The government will say, we are closely monitoring the situation. That means that fellow is, looking at the television, how the Bangalore is sinking. So, this is the, officially they told they are closely monitoring the situation. I like some of these words, closely monitoring the situation. Law should take its own course. That is the second one. And justice will be done without fear or favor. These are some of the things, in case some of you are, students are planning for civil service, you should mug up all these things so that you will be able to tell correctly, right? So after that, this is pending, right? Then Karnataka, there was a huge hue and cry about, I think some of you may have reading paper and other thing. One group, Linkayat, they wanted to even have a separate religion. They told, we are not Hindus, so we are alag. So that reason is very simple. They run huge number of educational institutions. And they feel if they are, outside Hindu fold, then government regulation, they will become minorities. So they will get a lot of exemptions from all this. That's a crucial reason. Because the largest educational institution is run by this group, Linkayat. Anyhow, there was a huge hue and cry. We must have a census in Karnataka, within Karnataka. And Karnataka is reasonably a well-known state for earlier conducting the socio-economic census. They have conducted and they have created on that Schedule 3, Schedule 3A, Schedule 3B, like that, Each one is where you will, when you can enter government service and when you can go up the ladder. All that is fixed. So, 2017, they did this census in Karnataka, exclusively. And something very interesting came out of it. Traditionally, it is believed Linkayat are supposed to be the largest group in Karnataka, 19%. traditionally, belief only it is, Okkaligas are supposed to be something like 13-14%. These are the two dominant groups. One more in northern Karnataka, one more in southern Karnataka. Likkayat are represented by the current chief minister, for instance. He is a Likkayat. And Okkaligas are, Devagowda is very well known in that belt. Nobody knows the actual number. This is one thing which you should know, or rather put it into your thing. Nobody knows in India which caste has got what numbers. All these TV experts and discussions and other thing are all what I call POTA data. POTA. What is POTA data? Pulled out of thin air. So you just say. So one discussion I was involved, that fellow told, Yadavs are majority in this constituency. So I asked him after the discussion was, how do you know Yadavs are 42? Arey Baba, the fellow anchor was Yadav, so I thought I will. This is what is happening in our. Nobody has got any clue to all impressions and feelings and other. So Linkayats are 19 and Okkaligas, so they used to, you know, like number of seats and other thing will be decided based on this. This census revealed that scheduled caste are 20% of Karnataka, first point. More interesting point is Muslims are 17%. So 20 plus 17 is 37. Then there are smaller groups, Kurubas, Idgas and other things. If you add those groups, it will be something like 42 to 43%. So huge number, purely from the point of view of politics. So what did they didn't, this report has not been released. I am again giving the, they are closely monitoring the situation. In the assembly, off and on this, there is only one BSP person is there in Karnataka assembly. He was earlier in the government, he came out of the, it's a very confused situation whether he's in the government or outside the government. Anyhow, he used to ask, and sometimes some members of some parties will ask, and the government will say, we are reading the report, we are trying to, and so there, I don't think they are going to release it, because it revealed Linkayats are hardly 12 to 13% only. And much interesting is Okkaligas are less than 10%, 8 to 9%. So they are not going to. So this is the, I wanted to tell you this data on this is extraordinarily frugal, practically non-existent. Whatever is available is contrary to popular belief and faith. So that's why they are not getting list. Okay. Then there is, of course, always a large number of people who want to abolish caste. That's another very major. People have been trying from Lord Buddha to, Ambedkar. Everybody wanted to. That seems to be like a cockroach caste. You know, it's there always. Everybody wants to abolish it. Everybody wants to. It's not going away anywhere. I can assure you on that. Point is, each caste is a sampradaya. People forget this elementary principle. Every caste, subcaste has a... What is sampradaya? We mean in terms of birth, namakaranam, in terms of mundakam, all these, so many things, death ceremonies, birth, marriage ceremonies, all these are unique for some variations in the adjacent places, geographically, linguistically, and other. Betrothal, all these things. Then, for instance, couple of castes have 13th day as the last day of this death ceremony. They feed people. They know some parts of India it's called Vaikuntha Samaradhana, some other places, different names are 13th day. Some I know are doing it on the 10th day itself. And some caste is very interesting, I have listed them. It's only 6th day. In 6th day it's all over for them. So, it's a very fascinating thing, because if you want, what do you want the government to do? Government announced that some caste do the shaving of the head on the time of birth itself. Some wait for 1 year. Some do it in 6 months. Some do it according to that nakshatra and other things. So, a lot of. So, what do you want? Government announced that 5th month everybody should do mundakam. The barbers will be in shortage in India. if Government of India announced that only in the fifth month you can do, it's not possible. Think about it. Everyone is a sampradaya. What are you going to do actually? Of course, everybody is talking about this uniform civil code that's fashionable today without understanding what they are in for. It's not going to be very easy, to make them all, you can't say everybody should have the death ceremony closed on the 10th day. Why? That's what the Government of India wants. They cannot decide like that, right? It's going to be a very cumbersome thing. And we have one positive thing. There is NSSO, now it's called NSO, National Statistical Organ, which is under CSO. This NSO has contained economic census. It's available in the website, actually. Exhaustive. It's one of the very, very fascinating economic census. They conducted in 1998, covering 35 million establishments. What they mean is, it includes the roadside fellow who sells puchkar, who sells idli, to ONGC, Hindustan Lever, and other things. All of them are covered. As long as there is a economic activity, that means that fellow sells something and earns some money. Those which are household within the house where there is no selling take place are not included. Otherwise, all other activities are covered. Some of them are covered using sampled method, and we are not going into those technical things. 35 million they covered this. In 2005, they had 42 million, and 2013, 60 million, the coverage I am talking about. Interesting thing is, in 98, 45% of all these economic activity establishments, 45% were owned by SC, ST, OBC. In 1998, in 2005, 52% is owned, and 2013, 60% of it is owned by SC, ST, OBC. And now they are doing the 2017, not yet released or anything. But my discussion tells me that it could be as high as 70% now. So what is happening in the country is Vaishyavization is taking place. Everybody is becoming a Vaishya. There is one Dalit Chamber of Commerce, some of you might have heard about it. It's very powerful actually. It is being consulted by the Finance Ministry before presentation of budget and other thing. There is actually one lady, I'm not, Kamani I think, Kamani Tubes I think, yeah. 600 crore turnover she has got. And in South it is so many Dalit entrepreneurs are doing very well actually. So all are into business. The whole country is Vaishyavization. Earlier, government used to be the Vaishya. Now, government is coming out, hopefully, of government should focus as a Kshatriya. It should actually take care of the security of the people. So, everybody is... So, the traditional model is Marwaris, Chatyars, all these people. But after that, a lot of agriculturists have gone into business. Reddys, Kamas, Linkayat, Gowdas, all over the country. Patidars are, many of them are agriculturists actually, and they have all gone into, so this is the second. And then Brahmins went into business. Mainly, of course, one of the software thing. Narayan Murthy, you can take it as one of the illustrative thing. Who comes from what you loosely call a middle class family or something, right? And others, as I told you, the Dalits are also into this, scheduled caste are also into business. So all are. So, the Vaishyavization of the country is taking place. All are becoming Vaishyas. But it's a very attractive thing because business unites caste. Let's be very clear about it. Politics divides. This is something very, very important to note according to. So, business has got its own thing. And many people are, for instance, lot of criticism and the thing comes that... this caste is not having, so many PhDs. Muslims are not having so many, PG people and all these TV debates. Are they don't want to. Why are you harassing them? Why should everybody be a PG, postgraduate or a doctorate? many of the Muslim I know, they go up to school or something, then get into business. They are interested in doing business. Many of the Gujarati people I know, they do BCom. Ultimate for them is doing a BCom, get into business. And very interestingly, my study in all these clusters, most of the entrepreneurs who are doing roaring business are all less than 10th standard, 7th class or 8th class. So actually there is a correlation between education and entrepreneurship. If you are highly educated, you are not a risk taker. Very less educated people are more risk takers. Reason is very simple. One of them explained to me, sir, you go to the swimming pool, you sit on the bench and go on thinking, you know, modeling and other thing. You know, what is the depth, what are the waters, warm water or cold water and this and that. And you go on, you know, you are all intellectuals, you know, you think about it. And then you come home, you won't get into swimming at all. So we just jump into that. It's all right, once in a while, right? So this is another very interesting thing. Don't harass people that you are not a PhD or anything. This very often, government report will come. Government report will say something. Jots are not having adequate PhDs. Why should they have enough PhDs? Is that a aim in human life or what? That you must have a PhD. It's all right. They don't have a PhD, right? One fellow was telling me the other day in the interview that his father is a pani puri seller. He has come to do. It's all right. Nothing wrong. You could do PhD or you don't have to do. Nothing. There is no bar on that. So I think we have completely distorted and twisted type of a attitude toward things. Okay. So that is what is most interesting. Advantages are plenty. Provision of initial capital. That is something very, very important. The initial capital comes from the community. And the same thing economic survey reveals, believe me sir, 90% of the establishments in India do not have access to institutional capital. 90%. You won't believe it even. They all have access to capital from family, relatives, caste and these things. Where the NPA is also very low because there is a social pressure. If you borrow from your uncle or if you borrow from your own community person, the other fellows in the community are watching you in the sense they would like a concept of izzat or something. You know, I cannot, kandan ka izzat, I cannot be a fellow who is defaulted or something. And similarly, market access, this is another important thing. Many of the urban areas, the fellows who run the retail shops in my places, Nadars, Muslims, these are the two major groups actually. When the expansion of the city take place, the newer places, these fellows, assistants actually go and set up retail shops further there. And these fellows help them actually. Market access. I ask them, why don't you start? No, sir, he also has to have his business. Let him. So, what Satyarthi says as child labor is actually a training for becoming entrepreneur again. They are not child labor. Child labor, if you look at it from the European perspective, they are, but they are not actually. So, market access is something which is same way international. Many of the exporters I have come across, this one of them is, what is that called? His name is Armugam. Somebody called him as Arnold Armugam. Because the day that Arnold landed on the moon, he was born. So he has got some huge empire in the. He's from, as I told you, that Gounder community, and he's exporting. He travels to France, first class Air France, not business class or anything. He's considered as one of the major customers for. He wears ordinary dhoti and. Once I was coming back after some seminar or conference, I was coming cattle class, of course, no way of any other, I was maybe standing also. Anyhow, I was talking to him, I asked him, how do you manage? Because you know only Tamil, right? He told me a very interesting thing. Professor, in France also people don't know English, you should know that. So, it's not that I don't know English, they also don't know. The point is, even though they are not very highly educated or anything. He was telling me an interesting thing. New markets are coming up in Bulgaria and adjacent. he has encouraged other people, in of course in his own community, extended relatives and other thing, to go to those markets. He himself is not, he says, I have got enough in my hand and other thing. And intricacies of local laws, this is another major thing. For them, it's not very easy to employ a group of chartered accountants, lawyers and other thing. So most of them rely on their own community network. You know, for instance, the Food and Adulteration Act, you might be knowing about it. It's one of the draconian act in India, actually. Fortunately, it is not eligible for the households. Otherwise, they will come into my home and that food inspector of Delhi Municipal Corporation will tell my wife, your cooker is not clean and, you know, it's not. It's only for hotels and other things. Every week in many cities, these people go and that fellow will give a envelope. These acts, I call it as envelope acts. It's nothing, there is... I can tell you, sir, every regulation in India by government is a mechanism for government employees to make money. There is absolutely nothing else, or sorry to tell this, but I told this even when I was in job, not that I am retired. So it's a every regulation. They will say strengthening the regulation means how more bribe can be. So if you want to set up a new thing, that other fellow will tell you, that fellow you give 500 rupees, it is enough. Don't give more. And this fellow you give 250. These are the intricacies of the local laws and regulation. That is, you know, somebody has to tell you silently but clearly, so that you don't get into any problem. Even in US, it's a question of following all the thing. What they call, keep your nose clean, right? And you want to start a motel or something. Local Patel will tell you, you know, where to parking should be proper and this is proper, that, you know, all the hundreds of same way here in India, it is a mechanism of how to adjust. Shops and Establishment Act, it's another draconian act. I always suggest that you must have every economics, politics, JNU student, he should be told, you go and set up a shop in Jharkhand or in Karnataka or one small petty shop. Give him some amount. Actually, he should set it up, following all the rules and regulation. Right? That's a challenge. And then you come, and then you do all your agitations, totally. First you go and set it up. Right? I'll tell you, sir, honestly, it will take an year or year and a half at least, minimum. If he has to go through all the In Karnataka, you know, 19 regulations are required for setting up a small shop. If you have to put a signboard, it has to be approved by the local corporation. Entirely in Kannada, that is okay. If you put Kannada in English, Kannada should be 60% font of the English font. English is supposed font 8. Kannada should be 60% more. So that's a... How to overcome this? One fellow, one inspector will come, you hand over an envelope. Very envelope. Shops and Establishment Act says, around the shop, things should be clean. 15 years I am buying bread for my dog. Every day, go and pay 20 rupees or 50 to the shop. Between you and me and the shop, there is an open drainage. 15 saal, it is same drainage is there, nothing. So, fellow should be closed. Right? Its surrounding is not, no rat should be there. Sunshine should come into the... One minister openly told that if you have to implement all these things, all the shops in Karnataka has to be closed. Why have that? Shops and... Like this, there are plenty. This ease of doing business in Delhi, you know, this ministry is talking, are all bogus things. It's very interesting, you get into some TV studio and, you know, discuss ease of doing. They really do not know what is happening, what is required at the municipal level, at the corporation level, at the state government level. That is the, anyhow, these intricacies, I should share it with you. One hotel fellow I asked, why don't you fight it out? Right? Not possible, sir. On a Friday evening, he can down my shutter, telling that there is some. So I was put in a government committee actually to look at this show, Food and Adulteration Act. I was mostly I am wrongly put into committees, not rightly. I can assure you on that. And some discussion was there. Somebody asked me, "What is your?" I told, "Scrap that. Scrap it. Nothing will happen." There is something called enlightened self-interest. The fellow who sells, he wants customers next day also. If he gives me an idli which is harmful, nobody will go to him. Nowadays, and now social media is so powerful. If the dosa comes with cockroach, that girl will take a picture of dosa, picture of cockroach, herself, all selfie she will do, and put it into the net. It will go to Venezuela within a matter of months, matter of minutes, right? So, the enlightened self-interest will make him. Even if he sells roadside puchka, I have seen, they are very cautious. They may not use the best water available in the country, but still they are worried because they want the customer base. So, I told, no, sir. I asked them, give me a list of people who died in Bangalore eating in all this. There is no such. Nobody has died. There are more people have died due to cars run over them and trains run over them than eating. Why have this act at all? So I asked this hotel fellow, why don't you fight it out? He told, not possible, sir. He's a very elderly man, very seasoned man. He gave me one interesting thing. What he told is, sir, do you know in Dakshin Kannada, that is the, there is a thing which we tell each other. One buffalo was running very fast on the road. Mad, it was running like anything. So one elephant stopped it. Why are you running so, you know, like, no, some new regulation has come. They are arresting all the cows because they feel the cows are creating a lot of difficulties, debate and discussion. New government has decided we will arrest all the cows to minimize social tension. But why are you running? You are a buffalo. Elephant asked. Buffalo told, sir, it will take at least 20 years for me to prove in Indian court that I am a buffalo and I am not a cow. The elephant also began to run. You got the point, right? Our judiciary is so fast. So that is what that Udupi friend of mine told. Okay, availability of credit. And last but not least is acceptance of failure. That is something very, very important. And if they fail, there is no negative remark or anything. Others try to understand why they failed and maybe try to help them out in order to facilitate another thing. And some, you know, some clusters are very interesting. One of my students came and told, sir, caste should be abolished. I told him 100% I am with you. You try to get me a bulb in Bangalore, South Bangalore or anywhere. A simple bulb, you know, this, which is not sold by Rajasthani. This is a condition. You can't just go and buy a bulb. Get it, who is not a Rajasthani. They are called Mewaris. They are not Marwaris. One area called Mewar. They are all. He took, I told, if you want, I will give you the amount also. No, sir, I will. He, 1 or 2 days he tried, I think. He came back to me. Sorry, sir, I am not able to get your bulb. But you wanted to abolish caste. Where is that? When are you going to? It's not possible. They have built it over a long period of time. They have access to, you know, inventory material. And you know, various other network and other, it's not, and it is not only for this. For instance, today garbage removal in Bangalore is done by Mohammedans. The chicken market in Bangalore is, believe me sir, 7 Muslims. Sat, whole greater Bangalore is served by them. This Hindustan Lever, big MNC, they wanted to enter into this market and they tried 2-3 years and then they set shop. They understood that this is not a market where they can penetrate. It's not a, so many of them. Tiles market is traditionally Linkayat. You tell me a product, I will tell you which is the community. Nothing wrong about it. They have built it over a, And incidentally, others are not completely barred or anything. But basically, because of the numbers, these people are having a hold over it. And obviously, they would have give and take. You know, if, for instance, if that fellow doesn't have a bulb, he will immediately send the boy to the next shop by cycle. And that fellow will go and bring, you know, his own group. That's why the advantage is there for him. So this is something which we have to keep in the back of the mind, that it is a large number of these groupings are. And one more extra point I would like to say before I conclude. There are too many, many of these clusters are also having other externalities. For instance, in many of these places I have seen, colleges have been started by these communities. Community college or whatever you call it, caste college actually. Quite a number of them have been, some of them engineering and some of the, of course in South at least, some of the colleges are getting closed because of lack of demand from students for some disciplines like computer science and other things, because these colleges are not really so. But many other disciplines they are continuing. So large number of educational institutions have been started by these caste groups actually. Plus, many a places, local temples, and where it's a dance, drama and other thing, and auditorium and chowltries for marriages. What I want to say is there are a lot of externalities which they have helped in creating. It's not just, you know, they are, what one can call, exclusively for their own business and they don't care. They care for the entire surrounding. Periodically, you know, this every Diwali time, one noise is made, this... what is that place? Virudhunagar. All children, child labor is employed and other. Now it is not child labor, it is more pollution. That's a major, they say only whole Delhi is now dead because of Diwali. These crackers and so stop the cracker and you know some 8 lakh people are employed there actually. And finally it seems that it's not the crackers which is burst for 1 or 2 days which is the reason. It is more adjacent state burning crops and anyhow. Cracker have become a popular, in the popular imagination, Diwali is the major crime for Delhi. Like another popular imagination in UP is, holy time all the fellows are wasting water. They are, you know, other time I don't think they bathe or anything, but holy time at least, they, you know, these are, you know, huge number of these environmental NGOs are floating around in the country. So, they are doing, you know, so many other, but that Virudhunagar, if you take the per capita educational institution, schools and colleges, highest district in the country. This data is not told by anybody. Huge number of educational institutions are started by the NADARs, which are supported by them. And so, anyhow, last I would like to say, Swami Vivekananda actually, he came back from US after his lecture and, you know, then he was doing a tour, actually, from, it's called Colombo to Almora. You know, that time, India was including of Sri Lanka and, you know, there is no... So he was, and by then, word of mouth is, and newspaper is famous, spread. So everybody was calling him, Hindu Society, Hindu Sangam. Very interesting, in 1897, 96, 97, all the, you know, groupings were known as Hindu Society, Hindu Sangam and other thing. Secularism has not permeated by then, you know, like, otherwise they would have told Sangam only, because you cannot have a, but that time I think people were more innocent or whatever it is. So they were all, so in, he was giving a speech in Jaffna. Right. This is called Lectures from Colombo to Almora, 1897. He says, the older I grow, that itself is fascinating to me. He lived for what, 37 and a half years, 38 only. He says, older I grow, you know, where now we think, we treat, you know, 52, 53 fellows as youth icons and other thing, right? I think 60, I think, I don't know, L.K. Advani, is he youth icon still? Possible, I don't know. So, but 38, he says, the older I grow, the better I seem to think of these caste and other time-honored institutions of India. There was a time when I used to think that many of them were useless and worthless. But the older I grow, more I seem to feel a diffidence in cursing any of them. For each one, we should recognize is an embodiment of experience of centuries. So there is something, you know, this is lectures from Colombo Talmora. He, you know, different places, different aspects he was talking about another thing. So, couple of things we will recall. Aggregation is taking place in politics. Caste aggregation is taking place in terms of larger grouping. One, caste by and large unites in business between Hindus, Muslims and various other groups. Because see, business wants, by and large they want peace, most important. They don't like any riots or running around or anything. Any type of business. And these small businesses are most affected by all this call for hartal or band or anything. Because every day they have to earn something. So business by and large unites. Politics divides. That is the second thing. And third is Vaishyavization of India is taking place. Everybody is becoming a businessman. If you can't do anything, then you join some institution to do your PhD or do your PG or if you are a useless fellow only today. Otherwise, you get into business. So that's a point. And lesser educated people are much more risk-taking in our country. They are, you know, more able to compare to, you know, sort of entrepreneurs on the other side. And last but not least is, there are externalities also. There are a lot of benefits which they have provided, these clusters. They are not just, you know, education, economic clusters only. They have got other plus points also. So I think we should recognize this, maybe, and look at this in a different perspective. That is what I would like to conclude. Thank you very much for your patience. And right. No, the number is small. So you can
hello, hello.
Sir, my name is Dhruv Trivedi. Huh? Dhruv. Dhruv Tarawala Dhruv. Dhruv Trivedi. I'm a management consultant by profession.
Right.
My question, in fact, there are two questions. The first question is more related to your mentioning of the fact of the Marxist thinking about the Purusha Sukta Shloka, where the four varnas have been enumerated. My question is not that. My question is, how is it, or can we have some idea as to how these varnas got disseminated into castes or jatis? Because jatis are very different. And regionally, you will find that the jatis are different. Most of the Karnataka has a different set of jatis. West Bengal has a different set of jatis. Punjab has a different set. So my first question is, how did that dissemination happen? Number one. And my second question is, from what I gather, from whatever you mentioned, is that eventually, is it a utopian thought that we are chasing in terms of abolition of the caste? So, these are my two questions.
Okay. First question, the mechanism of the hierarchy of caste and all this, Varna to this, it is exclusively the British creation. Most important to realize. That's the way they thought is the best way to rule the country. In the north, they could have much more significantly Hindu-Muslim type of issues. But in other parts, they used the caste as a mechanism to divide. And they created a hierarchy. And then, the lower hierarchy is being harassed by the upper hierarchy. It was an extraordinarily beneficial thing for them. And obviously we also, you know, large number of our historians and thinkers and other thing jumped into that. The second is in terms of abolition of caste. This I have been hearing for a very, very long period of time, right? I think it's a lot of urban areas, intercaste marriages are taking place and other thing. But again, one of the spouses' caste is adopted. You know, for instance, intercaste marriage may be there as long as they are reasonably following some of these sanskaras. When does the mundakam take place? After the child is born. So either it is boy's thing or it is, one of the thing is adopted. In India, of course, by and large, the boy's side is adopted. The girl, you know, get. So I know some velamas who have, in Andhra Pradesh, who have married this kamas, right? Maybe over, I used to joke to them, over a period of time, you know, vel kama or, you know, ka velama, caste may develop. That's also quite possible. New type of thing. Otherwise, it is not, you know, significantly going away. Or, you know, it has its own role to play. My whole point is, I am not even serious, you know, thinking, why should it go away at all? You say that caste discrimination is, that's a totally different issue. That obviously, you know, nobody, why caste is, any type of discrimination based on language or any of these, obviously we are not going to accept. Right? There is no point in suggesting that it should go away. Another way to look at it is most important. This is a separate thing. We will not get into that anyhow. If all castes go away, actually it is a major threat to the world Abrahamic religions. This is most important. Many people don't realize at all. Many of my Marxist friends, I tell them, if you abolish all castes, where is the next identity? They will all say they are Hindus or something, which is actually the much more. You can't have something like, you know, what do you call, 800 crore fellows calling themselves one identity. It is the biggest threat, and some of them may want to invade Middle East also. No, seriously, I'm telling, no joke. If you have 200 crore fellows following one particular thing, it's not a... So for the world peace, at least, according to me, the divided we stand, right? Better we are actually. Not united we stand. You know, our division, it's not, it's a 100 flowers bloom, that's what Mao Zedong told. Right? Let 100, you know, it's not a vicious or venomous, no, nothing. And actually, if you go into that, you know, downstream areas, you find many of the castes are happily coexisting. There is absolutely no problem at all. Right? Some castes have, non-vegetarian. Then they will say, Amavasya, we don't take non-vegetarian. You know, like, they adjust each other and go. This only issue is between, you know, you will hardly find any problem if, between a Jat and a Kurmi or, these type of groups. The only issue is, that's also highly political, is because of the SC, scheduled caste, interaction with some OBC person goes and get married to a scheduled caste man, the girl, then it creates, there again very interesting, I have observed many places, if the scheduled caste girl marries a OBC boy, it's not so much of a complication. But if a scheduled caste boy marries a, that's more, the of course the word Dalit, I don't want to use, it's a, you know, church created word actually, because among scheduled castes, there are again hundreds of, you know, we tend to think scheduled caste is one. There's a lot of urban people. Problem is, they tend to easily think that, okay, there is only one. No, there are as many subgroups within scheduled caste. In Karnataka, we have Edakara and Valakara, you know, left-handed and right-handed. This, and then water sharing and water non-sharing. So many complications are there. Let's not. So this, according to me, this is just more political. That's all. Nothing. Otherwise, you hardly come across. I do not know when a Jat girl marries a Rajput or something, whether the riot take place, whether they fight with each other and kill each other. I don't know actually. Similarly, when a Kurmi marries Yadav, what happens? It's not, but when a scheduled caste gets into that, then church jumps into it, political party jumps into it, and all these things come, right? So that's a, so that's all. So I don't think, so caste abolition, kindly look at it also as a threat to world peace. So most important, right? Anything? Sorry.
Sir, Ramnivas Gurja, MPLA student, JNU. Sir, my question is simply related to institutional discrimination based on caste.
No?
Institutional discrimination based on caste. Means simply we are mainly when it comes to higher education, there is this interview or viva voce kind of things. Then simply persons coming from these communities, means marginalized communities, face because there is a lot of discretion placed on that committee. That's where the role of caste played very much. Means if we don't abolish means caste, then how we means solve that problem of institutional discrimination?
Institute like?
Institutional discrimination based on caste.
Institutional discrimination, I am not understanding what. You mean some people get preference in admission?
Yeah.
That is, according to me, this is a very strongly I am putting it. It's a very minor issue actually. See, if you give a reservation to one person in government job or something, he and his family only will benefit. But the entire Nadar community has come up not due to government reservation. It is due to business. So the important aspect which we should recognize is the business tries to boost the entire community in terms of network and other things. These government jobs, and you see, only 15% in India are in government job or in big private sector job. 85% are self-employed fellows, first of all. So whenever somebody argues government, well, how much government job you have?
Nothing. Not simply government jobs. I am simply talking in terms of choice. If somebody wants to pursue his study, then this education should be accessible to everyone, irrespective of their caste, all kinds of ascriptive identities.
100% agreed. Huh?
Means those identities should not come in his or her way.
No, his education is denied to somebody because he is belonging to scheduled caste in this country.
Not denied, but in subtle form, it's simply reinforcing all those ideas, because whole discretion is put on that committee that decides, or in that committee, this kind of discrimination takes place. Means based on not only on caste, but based on institutional affiliations or regional grounds.
That will always be there. You know, as long as you have positive discrimination, there will always be a sense of alienation that we are not in, we are not out, right? That will always be there. It's very difficult to. So that is not going to fully, you know, solve anything. These are palliatives actually, and people make a big, according to me, 100% government jobs you reserve, nothing will happen. Right? What will happen? Nothing. Because so less percentage only are government employees in this country. Right? And let us be very blunt. The clamor for government employment is not due to patriotism. It is due to bribery, corruption, where you can earn more money. That's all. Not that, you know, people are very wanting to serve the government or.
Example of JNU again. The JNU wala will always prefer a communist he knows who is the person of the right ideology. They just don't want to reduce the person.
On all those grounds, discrimination is always done. Means political.
So you reduce. So you do away with the why almost. You do away with interview. That's the solution. The identity won't be there in the examination. No? So that thing won't
be
there.
Give me example from government. Though we are critical of government all the time. For example, just to give you a quote, an example. How the even government machinery is changing. RTOs, where you get your driving license. It's a huge adda of corruption, what sir call as, envelope thing, you give an envelope, you get your license. Now government is doing away with these, licenses which humans have to give.
Correct.
You sit in a simulator,
that's
simulator
all.
Processor fails you, that's it, you're done.
My wife had to give 3 times.
See, education, I will tell you one minor thing. See,
At least in
Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu, all these are highly politicized, I am telling you. For instance, a girl committed suicide in IIT very recently. There are 63 people who have committed suicide in Tamil Nadu, not IITs. All smaller institution where, see, people, I am not being cynical, but people can commit suicide with heavy stomachache also. Because if a farmer commits suicide, immediately it is told government is responsible. Farmer can commit suicide for 100 things. That his wife is having a relationship with somebody else, he may come. The reason is, so many kids have come. But this particular one is unfortunately a Muslim. And she has joined. Highly politicized it is now. So what is happening, I am telling you very seriously, what we call gradeflation is taking place. No professor wants to fail anybody. He just gives mark. Let him get lost. Nobody, I am telling you, in another 3-4 years, nobody will fail. I won't be surprised if everybody gets 70-80 marks. Get out. Because who wants... You see, that professor, I know him actually. He is a decent fellow. He is not a cantankerous fellow. His name is told in all the TV channels. He is already told he is a culprit. The only thing pending is Arnab Goswami and Mariam Shekhal or what is that? They want him to be in the jail immediately, tomorrow morning. Based on some flimsy, she has left some message or... I'm telling you, this is completely comprehensively, this will finish our system. Of course, some people say, what if? That's also there, right? That is why the proportion of people who go abroad after school, it has 8 times increased in India. After school. When I was in the college, normally after graduation, after engineering, or the tendency was to go abroad to do further. Now, after school itself, people are going away. And all are shouting, $8 billion we are spending. $8 billion expected to increase to $20 billion. In other countries, Australia to Auckland to Alabama. Now, that is what people will, water will find its own level. This is what will happen. Okay.
Sir, I have a question.
One question, you said that business is a great leveler. People won't deal with, they won't get involved in conflict because of this. When business involved. What I see is that there are fields where business itself induces conflicts. For example, the meat industry. The meat industry.
That's a specific.
The leather industry.
Yeah, because of the halal.
In last 10 years, 15 years, all the Hindu,
Khatiyars. Khatis are gone.
The Khatis, they were having much of meat business. Throughout UP, they have been destroyed. In Lucknow, from my place to the railway station, there were at least 20 Khatik shops. All of them have been closed down. All. And Muslims have been replaced. So, there is a conflict also, and the rivalry also, and
Sure.
Systematic discrimination also. So you were talking about institutional government. There is a societal discrimination where they try to influence others and eradicate people in business. I'm not talking about the education, but
yeah, yeah.
About economy. So in economics, it is a big thing. They won't allow others. For example, food vendors. You will see all of them gradually seeing only Muslims. Vegetable vendors, all of them getting Muslims. So they don't allow people to stand next. They don't allow them to sell. They don't, all the vending points, they'll be controlling, they won't be selling, they'll be throttling them. So that's how it works.
So I said almost a similar thing, you know, because we are talking about economics here, you know, as the core subject, you know, caste and economics. Monopoly is always bad for business, you know. And when I say that a particular caste is, you know, controlling it, and you have given numerous examples, of course, your book will have, you know, all these examples, as Dr. Saab was also, you know, explaining. Isn't it a kind of monopoly, you know, when a particular caste, you know, takes over? For example, you see halal meat, to give an example. Everybody says only halal meat is provided here. So obviously, you are taking all the jhatka traders out of the business story, and that is what has happened to all the jhatka traders, right from Kashmir to Somali, you know, they've been going out of the business. So, isn't that also bad in a way where a particular caste takes, you know, the entire business in its own?
Yeah, you know, of course, this is a very, very separate topic itself. By and large, among Hindu caste, there is not much of a, you are talking about religion, actually, and religion.
Caste has a monopoly, you know, taking over the business, and then.
No, there is, among, you know, if you look at other things, what we were discussing, none of them, nobody prevents you from getting into cracker industry or, you know, nothing like that. There is, incidentally, large number of people belong to SC are also now in cracker industry. There is a very interesting thing when some political leaders went, approached them, they told, don't come to our village. Because if you come, there will be, you know, unnecessarily. So this halal thing is a separate, you know, it's a global, not only in India. The Balinese have solved this problem by announcing explicitly by board that only jhatka meat we are serving here. All over. They have, you know, because Balinese is a small group actually, of number of Hindus are very, very small there. So, this halal thing is a, you know, is a global phenomenon actually. It's a way in which they would like to be. But there is a lot of resistance to it in UK as well as in US now. Because they slowly understand that this, it's a way of controlling the entire business actually. So, the KFC as well as other type of institutions are now cushioned. And I think the best way will be for people who eat in these should ask for jhatka meat. Very simple. I don't want halal meat. It's a finally customers who will decide. Why do you accept halal meat at all? There is no need for you to. And there is no religious ordained by, you know. It was not there 10-15 years before actually. If you go back in time, Hindu military hotels used to be very common. All over South India I have seen. So it will be written Hindu military. Military is, you know, associated with non-veg. Very simple. And in the South, Shaivites are supposed to be more non-veg. But in the North, actually, it is Vaishnavites. If you say you are veg, that means, oh, you are Vaishnav. You know, Vaishnavs are, it's a very interesting thing actually. Here I think Shaivites you can, anyhow. So, I think one way will be to people to demand in the restaurants. I have always been telling you I don't want halal. Why don't you assert, you know, after all, and you are not expected to eat halal. There is no, and there is no extra benefit by eating. People are used to it, that's all. There is nothing, and people accept it. So that's a, like Kerala for instance, the beef eating has become so common, which is not required actually. Because most of the places they literally push it down the throat. And so, and some people created as if it's a, you know, sort of hep activity. You know, if you eat beef, you are hep. So, this type of things, you know, I think it's a more of a global issue, if you ask me bluntly. Right.
So, one question.
Oh, okay. Because, we'll keep it as last question.
There are two aspects of caste. One is providing a huge amount of economic and social sense of discrimination, it should be erased. So how to balance between the two? Because they gone, all the unemployment would be gone. India didn't have unemployment. If this caste-based jobs were, I mean, अगर मुझे मेरे मुझे पता है कि मैं अपना जूते का बिजनेस कर सकता हूँ एंड आई बी अर्निंग क्रोर्स टू इट आई बी हैप्पी डूइंग दैट बट एट द सेम टाइम आई हैव टू बैलेंस इट विद सपोज आई वांट टू परस्यू अनदर जॉब गो गो आउट ऑफ दैट लिमिटेशन सो हाउ डू यू बैलेंस
इट विल आई एम श्योर यू नो वी हैव बीन बैलेंसिंग लाइक वाटर फ्लो इट विल एडजस्ट इट आई एम टेलिंग विदिन नेक्स्ट मे बी कपल ऑफ इयर्स गवर्नमेंट हैज टू श्रिंक. Government is broke. Many people don't even realize this. Government is broke, most places. And so government has to shrink. So there is not going to be much opportunity for so-called reservation and other things. And many of these institutions, you know, they are few and far between. So the post-education, where employment is not assured or anything, because slowly you are producing people who are unemployable. Quite a number of, I told you, engineering institution in our part of the country is getting closed because they are not having adequate. So when it started 100, 150 and everybody was shouting, how many engineers? And by itself it's what you call, water will find its own level. I'm telling it cannot be sustained actually. We make such a big noise about government has to shrink, government will close down. And some of these type of, where from he comes, these institutions will lose their relevance actually. You know, I'm not telling, sorry to tell, it's a, and people will just, you know, it there, so, you know, lot of things are there in the country which are, you know, like your zoo, museum, like that, there is one more extra place, it's all right, correct? That won't make much.
In terms of artificial intelligence or IoT, Internet of Things, can we afford to be uneducated?
Yeah, you can. There is no need for.
Because the economy is shifting.
Yeah, but no need for a formal. You know, people can. I know a lot of so called quote unquote illiterate people who handle many of these things much effectively. It is not much of a concern or worry. You don't have to go through a very formal system or anything. Lot of people
To augment your view, even Oxford and Cambridge universities have started accepting students without any formal education. Even Amazon, Google
doesn't force any formal education. It's not required at all. Huge number of retail street fellow, they are now using all this Paytm and other, where did they all pick it up, right? And our ability to pick it up is very high, actually. One example I will finish with, originally Maruti allotted a huge amount of money to train our Indians to know their cars, because they thought this ambassador is only one tube or whatever it is, you know. I remember my kerchief used to be asked by the driver sometime. He will tie it up and then drive the car. So Maruti was very worried because they felt that they are introducing very high technology and how will India manage in the 80s. They allotted. They have used only 15% of the budget. Because our fellows are, you go very deep interior, I have gone, and then if the car is struck, somebody will come. He will go under the car. He will repair it. May not be highly technically qualified fellow or anything. So our ability to absorb, we may not invent technology. We are very poor in that. But get used to it is much. I have got my mobile repaired in godforsaken places. One fellow will come and sir, wait. He will say, sit in the stool. I used to be worried actually. He will open it, do something, and then he will get. I asked some of them, how do you know, sir, we dabbled with, you know, we ourselves open it, then find out. And so technology usage, you don't have to. We are kings in that actually, right? And not only that, some groups in Punjab and Maharashtra and other, they even replicate it. They quietly can copy it and then make it. What is that thing, you know? And so That's not a. They say the made in USA. It is some Sindhi Ulasnagar Sindhi. So they quietly give it a market is. We are too good in many of those things. You don't have to have any worry at all, right? Okay.
Thank you, sir.
थैंक यू सर, आपका बहुत अच्छा कार्यक्रम रहा. हम लोगों ने आपको बहुत परेशान किया, वी डिस्टर्ब यू अलॉट. थैंक यू फॉर कमिंग एंड एनलाइटनिंग अस ऑन दिस वेरी पर्टिनेंट इश्यू. थैंक्स टू करण एंड रमित. करण ऑर्गेनाइज्ड ऑल दिस थिंग, सो स्पेशल थैंक्स टू हिम एंड रमित ऑफ कोर्स. सो थैंक यू ऑल फॉर कमिंग ऑल्सो. धन्यवाद.